Good morning, everybody. Here we are going springing forward. How many of you have the springing forward feeling this morning? Well, it's a good thing we walk by faith and not by sight. Amen. Hallelujah. Going, but we know we won't be back. Brother, if you're weary, lay your hand on Jesus' chest. We'll pick up his cross to carry and leave behind the rest. Yeah, this train rolls through my silent street. Yeah. We've crossed over into land, hope and free. Well, my Lord, he will provide for you, and he'll stand by your side. He'll be your friend and companion for this part of the ride. Leave behind your sorrows. Let this day be the last. Tomorrow there'll be sunshine and all this darkness past. Yeah, this train rolls through valleys and streams. Yeah, we crossed over into the land of hope and dreams. Yeah. This train was built for saints and sinners. This train carries losers and winners. This train welcomes harlots and gamblers. This train carries lost souls. This train, your dreams will not be thwarted. This train, yeah, your faith will be rewarded. This train, come on and ride this train, everybody. This train, come on and ride this train now. This train carries fools and kings. This train carries a little bit of everything. This train carries the wounded and the weary. This train carries the brokenhearted. This train, oh, your dreams will not be thwarted. This train. This train welcomes harlots and gamblers. This train carries life song is playing. Will you think about me for this? This train. Can you think of me for this? This train. Come on and ride this train down. This train. Come on and ride this train down. This train. This train's a clean train. This train. This train's a free train. This train. Well, it's washed by the blood from every stain. This train. Everybody ride Jesus' name now. This train. This train moving on down the track. This train. When I pass by here, ain't coming back. This train. Come on, everybody get on board. Come on, everybody get on board now. This train. Oh, your dreams will not be thwarted. This train. Everything will be rewarded. This train. Come on and ride this train now. This train. Come on and ride this train now. This train. Yeah, yeah, this train. Oh, I'm talking about the glory train. I'm talking about Jesus' train. Yeah, this train. Oh, this train. Yeah, this train. Yeah, this train. Yeah, this train. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah. Move around a little bit. Give it a go.
You're not Redeemer. Tell your neighbor that they may not know. Look at your neighbor and say, he's a redeemer. He takes the bad, and he makes it better than it ever would have been had there never been any bad. That makes the devil kind of stupid, doesn't it? It's all right. Everything's gonna be just fine. I said everything's gonna be just fine.
Thank you, Jesus. As we continue to receive his love, we've got some things to do just before the offering. Darwin, if you could come up. I don't know where you're at, but I don't know where Darwin went to. There he is. He was behind somebody. I know.
I'm not one of these people that a couple years ago I said I'm never going to be one of them people that says God told me this, God told me that, but now I'm there, and he put something into my heart this morning, and I've been struggling with this because Lord knows I'm not a public speaker. But before we give the offering tonight, there's four kinds of giving in the Bible. He told me the first one is tithe, and that's obedience. And that carries a blessing in itself. Not blessings, but it carries a blessing. The second giving is first fruits. And that's if you just got a job, if you just got a raise, you've lived without that $50 raise for the last however long, or that job. This is the first fruit that goes to God. Then there's alms. We can't confuse alms with the tithe. If we take the tithe and give it away, that's just giving up your tithe for the alms. And the alms is supposed to be given without with generosity. That's what first fruits is just generosity, and the alms are supposed to be done in secret. Don't take people's dignity away from them by giving them money, by giving them a blessing. And the fourth one is probably the most important, and that's the seed. That's not part of the tithe. If you're actually taking a part of your tithe and you're saying, I'm going to seed this money, I'm going to put this in fertile soil, it's not really put in fertile soil unless it's just given away. And this is a personal experience that I know it works. So that's why I listened to the Lord this morning when he put this on my heart. I went to a dollar store few months back. I walked past the little Bibles that they had there, and the Holy Spirit told me, buy one Bible. I says, how many? All of them. So I walked out of the dollar store with 67 New Testaments, and they're all gone now. And I give them away on the street. But anyway, that's one message that I had, that we're not supposed to confuse those. If we're taking anywhere of those three gifts or those three fruits and taking it as a tithe, you're actually stealing from God. So that's all I'd say. Thank you very much.
Excellent. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. That was wonderful. We're going to get ready to receive our tithes right now. And if you need a cash giving envelope, it's for your cash giving, it's for your credit card giving. And also, if you just want to write a check, it's the Glory Bound. And if you're watching by the internet, push donate. If you're watching by Facebook, hello. What we want you to do is go to our website, glorybound ministries.com, and go ahead and push donate. I want all of us to be participants in giving. And what I love about this church is we don't have to push giving at all. We're givers because we're just like him, and he gave everything. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for every giver here. I thank you for the wonderful testimony today in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Father, that you're speaking to all of us, everything that you have for us, Father, in Jesus' name. Whenever you're ready as a worship to God, bring it to the blue buckets behind the communion buffet or over here to this blue bucket. Do it as worship. And Mary has one thing she wants to talk to you about.
We have a special prayer request today, an emergency. So Colin's going to lead us in prayer for, and you explain.
I just got a call from my husband. His aunt is in the hospital. She woke up this morning, couldn't talk, couldn't breathe. They think that she may not make it. So he called and asked that we would pray. And this is really a stretch of faith for him. So I'm asking that everybody join in prayer with me, because if we can pray and see her turn around completely and totally, what a miracle would that be. And it would actually, I think, open his eyes some too. So Father, right now we lift up Mitzi. She's in Chicago, so we just extend our hands that way, and we lift her up right now. We speak complete and total healing and restoration. We say no to any kind of stroke that might be trying to take a hold. If there's a blood clot that has lodged itself in her heart, in her brain, anywhere, we call that null and void. We command it to dissipate right now in Jesus' mighty name. We speak to her heart and her lungs that they work in absolute divine wholeness the way they were created to be. We speak to her brain that there would be no cloud or confusion, that it would just work the way it's supposed to, that she would open her eyes and be able to speak in Jesus' mighty name, that she would be completely and totally restored, and that the doctors would stand in amazement as to the wholeness and the health that she's now in Jesus' mighty name. We lift up the family, that their eyes would be open to your holy presence, Lord, that they would be accepting and in faith, that she would be completely and totally healed and restored, and that they will absolutely stand in faith and know that you are the I Am, the God of God, the only God that can bring healing and restoration in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
You guys are getting an appetite for believing for impossible things, aren't you?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Woo. That's a good thing to have an appetite for. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, worship love you, Lord. We give you all the glory. Come on, let's dismiss the kids to wisdom word morning. Get ready for something uniquely special this morning. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And do one thing as they get the curtains going there. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Let's go ahead and pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I know there's some things that you want to open up to us. Maybe things that we have seen and things that we have not seen. I know that you have so much, and you are light years ahead of us. Father, we have your mind, have your heart, we have your spirit. We can comprehend in the realm of the spirit the things that you have for us. So today I speak life over every one of us in the holy name of Jesus, that your revelatory realm opened up to us, that we can easily receive it in the spirit man. In the holy name of Jesus, amen. There's a great man by the name of Dr. Wyatt, and he was best friends with Dr. Van Covering. And he was an archaeologist, passed away a few years back. And there were things that God gave him, and angelic visitations that he had, and things that God revealed to him, where he actually discovered where the Ark of the Covenant is. He actually discovered where Noah's Ark is. There's many discoveries that this man made. But they weren't allowed to reveal the fullness of what he has seen because he knew a certain year that God would have him do it. Well, they're starting to open him up now and starting to reveal that. What was interesting about the blood of Jesus, and we've run the video here before where Dr. Van Covering takes some of the blood of, not Dr. Van Covering, he actually went with Dr. Wyatt. Dr. Wyatt gets hold of the blood of Jesus, and Dr. Van Covering and Dr. Wyatt take it to a blood lab where they find out the blood is still alive. Okay, incredible. So you wonder, where did he get the blood of Jesus? And what he actually did as an archaeologist, they found where the cross that Jesus died on. And we know something that happened at that cross, that he shed blood. When that blood went into the ground, there was something very interesting under the ground of that particular cross. It happened to be where the temple had been covered over. It happened to be where the place of the Holy of Holies was. It happened to be the place where the Ark was at that time. And so the blood of Jesus, it was no accident that he just happened to be at that particular spot. It actually went right unto the Ark of the Covenant, right into the place, the mercy seat, is where his physical blood actually went, and then it was done in heaven. Dr. Wyatt was able to go into that place, scrape off quite a bit of blood, and be able to have it tested at several different places, all with the same result, that the blood is alive. And I'm telling you this because as we watch this video, and you can hear it from his own words, we're not born again by regular blood. We were not born in natural, just in the natural. We were born in the supernatural, by supernatural blood, by a supernatural DNA. Please run the video.
God has this on his time.
why I wanted you to see that is because his blood is alive inside every one of us. We've been born again by the DNA of God himself. When you look in the natural, like here there's some generations, there's Barbara. Barbara is a musician. She can play the piano, she can sing, she can do that stuff. That's one of her billions of talents. From Barbara's DNA and Leonard comes Wyatt. And Wyatt is able to be a musician, to do many other creative things. From Wyatt and Claudia's DNA comes Shani back there. And I remember this for Halloween one time. I was making her John the Baptist when she was a little girl, and so I was putting hair on her face, and she looked at the mirror and she said, "I look like Daddy." Well, there's a reason she looks like Daddy is because the DNA, musician, talented, because it's in the DNA. And from Hulka and Shani comes Jeremy, our grandson. There couldn't be any more talented. There couldn't be any. I'm telling you, it really did pass through the natural DNA. We look and we think, you know, boy, you can sure tell who they are. And Jesus said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Because he came straight, he was the outright, he came straight from that DNA. And you and I had a change of DNA when we got born again. When we got born again, instead of just having the natural DNA, instead of, well, this disease goes through our family, we have a supernatural DNA. We have the very fruit of God. We have the very power of God. We have the very talents and everything that God has. It's in our DNA. That's what we've been born again by. And I'm going to give you a definition of DNA. It says DNA is often compared to a set of blueprints, a recipe, a code, since it contains the instructions needed to construct other components or cells. An important property of DNA is it can replicate or make copies of itself. Jesus made copies of himself by giving us his very DNA. That's why he says, let it be done on earth as it is in heaven. Wyatt, would you come here for 1 second? I want you to explain the little thing that we've talked about before. You know, that little thing that you guys don't know what we've talked about, but he knows what I'm talking about. He's going to take just a few moments and explain this so we can understand something. And I hope that we get hold of that which we already know, but I hope we get some new things today.
Oh, okay. do you remember when Phil Mason was here? He explained this one principle of physics that if it's the relationship of matter. And he said, for instance, if you took an electron and split it in half, okay, and if you separated those halves of the electron, if you could separate them by a million miles if you wanted to, but you could if you change the spin direction of one of the halves of that electron, the other half of the electron would change its spin just the same way. In other words, the interconnectivity of matter, and that's like a real small example of the kind of interconnection that God talks about in the body. When one part of the body hurts, what happens to the whole rest of the body? It hurts, and it's because of this interconnectivity that God has made between like matter.
So, we can say this. According to the Word of God, we've been born again by Him. In other words, here's God. We've been hewn from Him, taken from Him. So whatever spin He's doing, guess what happens to us? Okay? So, we described it this way in California. It kind of worked for us real good. If it made a sound, it'd be going, they're going, quick, 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 quick. And then down here, it's going, quick, quick. Whatever this one, quick, quick. Met quick, quick. So God wants the body of Christ to move and flow with quick, quick. Okay, so keep that in mind as we do this. Now, I want you to see something that God doesn't speak necessarily just to an individual, but God speaks to a whole generation. God speaks to a DNA. And so, Galatians chapter 3 and verse 16. It says, now the promise, the covenants, the agreements were decreed and made to Abraham and his seed, his offspring, his heir. He, God, does not say unto your seed, your descendants, your heirs, as referring to many persons, but to your seed, your descendant, your heir, obviously referring to one individual who is none other than Christ the Messiah. So when God spoke to Abraham, he was actually speaking to Christ, who would come on the scene on earth. He was always, but would come on the scene years later. But he spoke to Abraham, therefore he was speaking to Christ. And when he spoke to Christ, he was speaking to us. The reason the blessings of Abraham come upon us is because God spoke to Abraham, he spoke to Christ, and therefore he spoke to us because he was speaking to the same DNA, the same exact DNA. So these two scriptures, these, next several are going to be really neat. Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 8. It says, furthermore, here in the Levitical priesthood, tithes are received by men who are subject to death. Well, in the case of Melchizedek, they are received by the one whom is testified lives perpetually. Now, this is important. A person might even say that Levi, the father of the priestly tribe himself, who received tithes, the tenth, paid tithes through Abraham. For while he was still in the loins of his forefather, Abraham, then Melchizedek met him, Abraham. Now, this is really wild. Abraham was generations, two generations before Levi comes on the scene. And yet, according to the word of God, when Abraham did it, who's it accounted to? Levi. Because Levi was in his loins. Therefore, whatever Jesus did 2,000 years ago, it gets accredited to us because we were in Jesus, even though he was years before us as far as physically manifesting. It says this in the Phillips translation, Hebrews 7 and verse 10. One might even say that Levi is the proper receiver of the tenths, has paid his tenth to the man, for in the sense he already existed in the body of his father Abraham when Melchizedek met him. He already existed. You, before you ever came here, before as God was creating the world, before you already were. I already was. We were in the heart and the mind of the Father, and we always have been. And so God, when he would bless Abraham for what Abraham did, it went down through the generations. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. It went all the way down through the generations because God blessed the seed, the generations. And so it says here in Exodus chapter 3 and verse 6, and you'll see this same term over and over again. He also said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Now, this is really an awesome thing. God always saw that there was one in the family line that he was able to connect with. And if he connected to one in the family line, he connected to all of the DNA. Let me ask you a question. Are all your body parts you? Okay, good. I just wanted to make sure. Okay. So the same DNA that is in my hand is the same DNA that is in this hand. Is that correct? Okay. So we're going to understand something that God has spoken. He got a hold. I wondered for a long time, and you might wonder this in your family line. I mean, we were great little Catholics, you know, my whole family line. So I'm thinking, where did this drive inside me come? Where did this come from that makes me go after this? It's like it comes from generations before. Somebody gave me a history book, and I read about a man that was just a few generations before, and he was a great miracle worker. And actually, when I mentioned it one time in church, two people at church said, that was my great-great-grandfather, too. Isn't that weird? We didn't even know. Your husband's one of them. Didn't even know that we had this relationship, but God did. And this man, he got hold of his DNA. He got a hold of him, probably maybe generations before. But when he got a hold of that DNA, guess what happened? It passed through the generations and through the generations and through the generations. So with you, buck's got to stop here. Whatever's trying to get through that's not good, stop it in your DNA and it'll stop. And verse 22, it says, and behold, a woman who was a Canaanite from the district that came out of, with a light, troublesome, urgent cry, begged, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is miserable and distressingly and cruelly possessed by a demon." They have some discourse, verse 25. "And she came kneeling and worshipped him and kept praying, 'Lord, help me.' And he answered, 'It's not right, proper, becoming, or fair to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs.' And she said, 'Yes, Lord, even the little pups eat from the crumbs that fall from their young master's table.' And Jesus answered her, 'O woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you wish.' And her daughter was cured from that moment." Wait a minute. She didn't have, that woman didn't have a demon, did she? Her daughter did. And Jesus spoke to the DNA of that woman, and it went all the way down and delivered her daughter. He spoke to the DNA. See, if your hand was cut and bleeding right now, you wouldn't go, "Oh, I'm going to have my church pray for you." You wouldn't do that. You would do everything, the rest of your body would do everything to stop that from bleeding, because it's part of you. And I am telling you, whatever issues you're having with kids, parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, whatever is that you're having issues with, you can take care of it from your DNA. You really can. You would take care of your hand and stop it from bleeding. You can speak into the generations. Not too long ago, my daughter called me, and she was having trouble at work. Not anything her fault. The account she was major in had left her firm. It didn't look like she would have much of a job. And she said, "I don't know what to do." And I said these words. I said, "Don't do anything. I'm going to take care of it by the DNA, because I'm getting hold of something." And so I'm going to tell you, Shani, exactly how I prayed. This is how I prayed. "Father, you know every hurt that I'm going through right now. And forgive me for just not trusting that you have given me this job and I will have it as long as I want it. And Father, I turn and I face you in this. And I say, I will not be fired, let go in any way. I will not have less. I will have more, and I will be promoted. I will have more. I will be promoted. I will have more. I will be promoted." And I kept doing this and speaking to my DNA as though I were her. And did anything happen with your job? Oh. Oh. Do you have a little more money than you had before? Oh. Because I was able to take care of some things in the DNA, because she came out of my body, and in all practical purposes for God, she's me and her son is her. You understand this? So I'm going to show you how this works. Aaron, if you'll come up here for 1 second, and then we're going to see some really awesome things. Aaron, do you have a son?
Yes.
Come up here. What is his name?
Cyrus.
Is he having any problems in school?
Slightly, yes.
Do you think if he tried harder, if he worked harder, if he did more, that he could kind of pull out of that?
Not in his own strength.
Okay, so what do you think he needs to do?
Let God.
Okay, so I want to tell you something. This guy here, he's having trouble with school. And this guy here, he's not letting God do what God needs to do. This guy here. I mean, I don't want to humiliate him, but he's not doing what he's supposed to do. You ever have this when your child or a child that you love is sick and you think, I wish so much that I could take it for them, because I could handle it and I would know what to do. Jesus wished that so much, he did it. But I'm going to tell you something. This man can speak to his own DNA, that which has come from his body, and he can make that DNA line up and trust God. Did you know that? It really is the truth. I could tell you story after story. We met a woman in California who told me her son was a drug addict. And I said, then you need to repent for being a drug addict. And she said, no, I'm not a drug addict. My son is. And I said, no, you are. And she said, you don't understand me. And I said, you don't understand me. It's like saying, my hand's bleeding, not me. Well, yeah, it's me. And yeah, that's you. And so an effective way for this man to pray is to take it as though it was him. Father, I repent for not doing the things that I'm supposed to by trusting you with my schoolwork, with trusting you with my anything that's going wrong. And he begins to pray as though he's his son, because for all practical purposes, this is his son. He just looks a little taller, that's all. Just looks a little different. But that's his DNA. And he can take care of his DNA And God takes care of his DNA. Okay, I just wanted you to do that. Thank you. Okay, so that really is the truth. When this woman that was in California turned around and prayed as though it was her, repented for being a drug addict, repented for all this lying and the conniving and the things that she had done, she tells me that from that day on, her son has not taken drugs again. How did that happen? The girl that had the demon, when the mother went home, she was totally fine on the couch. She's wondering, how did that happen? It happened because of the DNA. Okay, so now, this scripture should have been hard for all of us, because we know there's only one way to get saved. The way we get saved is if we would confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, we will be saved. Is this correct? Okay. But now, there's a scripture that says something interesting here. 1 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 13. If you are a woman with a husband who is not a believer, but he wants to live with you, hold on to him. The unbelieving husband shares to an extent in the holiness of his wife. And the unbelieving wife is likewise touched by the holiness of her husband. Otherwise, your children would be left out. As it is, they are also included in the spiritual purposes of God. What? It's in the DNA. God reached one part of the DNA and it went through the children. You and your household shall be saved. Well, I'm just waiting for my kids to do this. Well, quit waiting. They're already saved according to the word of God. It came from your DNA. It really did. So let's look at it in another translation here. It says in 1 Corinthians 7:14, for the unbelieving husband is set apart, separated, withdrawn from heathen contamination, and affiliated with the Christian people by union with his consecrated, set-apart wife. And the unbelieving wife is set apart, separated through union with her consecrated husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean, unblessed, heathen, outside of the Christian covenant. But as it is, they are prepared for God, pure and clean. Oh, my goodness. Now you're going to understand something. It says, I will deliver the one who is not innocent through the cleanliness of your hands. See, we are all one DNA in this room because we all have been born again by the same blood. We all have the same Christ Jesus, so I can take your place. See, this is going to take intercession to a different level. I can actually stand in your place and speak to that DNA and have it changed to its original purpose. This really is the truth, okay? So it says in 1 John 3:9, no one born, begotten of God, deliberately, knowingly, habitually practices sin, for God's nature abides in him. His principle of life, the divine sperm, remains permanently within him, and he cannot practice sinning because he is born, begotten of God. Begotten is a term used for your biological child. It said Jesus is the only begotten of the Father. That was then. But when Jesus became that seed that fell to the ground, to heal people. But Jesus understood the power of his DNA, of his saliva. People would seek to touch him because out from him flowed the miraculous. Out from him flowed the very healing power of God himself. When Jesus would lay hands, spit, whatever he did on somebody, it said he was moved with compassion. And the word compassion means to have passion come, but it means to pray, to help, to do something for someone else as though it were you yourself. I gotta tell you something. If I'm in pain, I'm gonna keep reminding myself to pray because the pain keeps being there. You may tell me to pray and I'll pray and then I forget about it. But God, when he went forth, he prayed for Bartimaeus as though it was blind Jesus because he understood part of my DNA, something's going wrong with it, and I've got to take care of it. In your family life, something is going wrong with your DNA. Take care of it. Bring it back. You've said, if it were me, I'd know what to do. Well, you're you, and you know what to do, so do it. And it will go through the family line. This is how God did it. It works that way. And so we see something here in the DNA that it's not only for the future generations, those who come out from you, it actually can go the other way. Remember this? In Luke chapter 1 and verse 15, it's talking about John the Baptist and when it was when Mary and Elizabeth encountered each other. Both of them are pregnant. He'll be great and distinguished in the sight of the Lord. He must drink no wine or strong drink. He'll be filled with and controlled by the Holy Spirit, even in and from his mother's womb. So when did John get filled with the Holy Spirit? In his mother's womb, he's filled with the Holy Spirit. Great. We had to go through all this time and all this stuff, and he comes out tongue-talking. And we thought it was just goo-goo-gaga. Nope, he was a babbler for God. But then Elizabeth and Mary meet each other in Luke chapter 1 and verse 41. And it occurred that when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb and Elizabeth was filled and controlled by the Holy Spirit. This is so weird. He's filled with the Holy Spirit. He's the generation that's going to come out. But instead, he goes backwards and gets his mother filled with the Holy Spirit. You can pray for relatives that are before you and you can pray for relatives that are coming after you. This is how God is. And so I want to give you one last example before we go into another section of this. How many of you know Denise Abernethy, Parody Queen? How many of you know Parody Queen? Okay. Parody Queen did an interesting thing. She went to a homeopathic doctor. And what they do is they put some blood, they take some blood from you, and they put it on a 3x5 card, put your name, date of birth, and all that. And they put it in a machine. And the machine will read what vitamins you're lacking, if you have an affinity towards a particular heart issue, some different things so that they can get you on the right meds. It's pretty cool. It's a quantum machine. It reads the DNA. So they read her DNA, and they got her on the right vitamins. They put the card away. A couple years go by, and she's in another country, and she's having some problems. She keeps going to the doctors there. Something's wrong. They can't find it. So she calls her homeopathic doctor and says, I don't know what's wrong. They've tried everything. And her homeopathic doctor says, well, let me go get your card. And she hadn't been there for a few years. So the homeopathic doctor goes and gets her card, puts it in the machine, and she said, oh, yeah, it's reading that 4 days ago you picked up a parasite, and this is what needs to happen. Queek, 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 queek. You understand that the very blood that she had from 2 years ago was still reading from her body right now. Now, that's pretty incredible. Because the blood of Jesus, though poured 2,000 years ago, is still alive speaking, mercy! And is still crying out and is still available for every one of us. We're blood bought. Keep that in mind. And we're going to start into this other part of what the DNA does for us. It's actually that you'll notice that science is always trying to catch up or it's getting some things around the same time. We began to have great revelation when diamonds were falling and different things were happening in the body of Christ. At the same time, people were finding huge diamonds in the ground that had nothing to do with Jesus. A lot of things happen at the same time. And right now we're starting to see that science is really seeing that our life was not supposed to be as short as it is. Go ahead and run the video, and Mary, your turn.
Cynthia Kenyon thinks she may have found one of the keys to a long life in a tiny, nearly microscopic worm called C. elegans.
So how can we learn anything about human aging from these tiny little worms? I know they look really different from us, but the basic processes of life are very similar at the molecular level. The good thing about these little guys is that they get old and die in just a little over 2 weeks. Okay, watch this. I'm going to show you something really cool now. So this is the normal worm when it's young. So it's a nice sprightly worm, what I expect a worm to look like, quite feisty. Now I'm going to show you the same kind of worms, but just 2 weeks later when they're old.
Wow.
So this is a normal worm when it's old, and you can see they're about to die. Oh, wow. So these are really slow moving here. I didn't think you could see aging in a worm so dramatically. Okay, so now what I'm going to show you are worms that are the same age, but you'll see that they look much younger. So these worms are the exact same age as the ones that we saw that were almost dead.
Yeah,
they look much younger, even though they're the same age. And they're wriggling about just like the other ones, huh? So they're like 90-year-old people who look 45. That's incredible. So what's different about these? We've changed one gene. That's all.
Kenyon changed one gene in the worm. Genes are made of DNA, long strings of four chemicals best known by their initials, A, G, C, and T. Together, they form the basis of all life on Earth. Kenyon found that there was a gene that scientists call FOXO, which had a central role in keeping her worms freakishly youthful.
What FOXO does is it helps the animal to protect and repair its tissues. The reason that it can do it is this one gene controls a lot of other genes.
FOXO is a master control gene, meaning it regulates hundreds of other genes, genes that have a profound effect on the worm's health.
So you can think of it as a superintendent of a building. So if you have a building, nice big building, obviously it has to be maintained. What FOXO does, what the building superintendent does, is to keep the building in good working order.
The superintendent makes sure that the electricity works and that the roof doesn't leak.
It makes sure that the walls are painted by hiring painters. It makes sure that the floors are swept.
But the superintendent doesn't actually do all these important jobs.
The building superintendent would hire workers to do these different things. What FOXO does in the cell is it switches on other genes.
Those worker genes do jobs like enhancing the immune system and protecting the cells from bacterial infection.
Some of these genes that protect the cell make proteins that will kill invading microorganisms. Others are switched on that are antioxidant genes.
Kind of like a rust inhibitor for a cell. Now, most living things need oxygen, but oxygen can actually be damaging to cells that aren't prepared to deal with it. And yes, there's a worker gene for that too.
I'd say altogether, there are probably about 100 worker genes that have very important roles. And together, what you get is a cell or a tissue or an animal that stays in really good working condition for a lot longer.
All those processes are actually directed by the FOXO superintendent gene. Kenyon tweaked one gene in the worms and made FOXO more active. With a more active superintendent, the cells became more resilient than normal, and Kenyon's worms lived twice as long. If there's one gene that dramatically increases lifespan in worm, using these samples, they tested 5 genes that had already been shown to help animals live longer to see if any of them would extend human life as well.
And based on that list, we found one gene.
You guys can bring down that video. I just wanted to show that there are some things that science is doing.
So I wanted to share a small part of this because I think we're still in the process of studying this and finding out more information through the power of the Holy Ghost. You know, back in the earlier part of the 1900s and through the early 1900s, the church wasn't moving really in much power in the Holy Spirit. As a matter of fact, the gifts of the Spirit were not really talked about. People didn't necessarily speak in tongues. And then during a certain time in history, Charles Parham raised up a group in his Bible school that when he was away on a trip, they wanted to have the power of the Holy Spirit. And by the time he came back from his trip, they were all speaking in tongues and had moved in a different facet of the Spirit of God. And so from there, we see that different things in our lifetime have evolved, different understandings of what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. For example, healing wasn't talked about too much initially. Now, healing is very accepted in the body of Christ, right? People come forward after church, lay hands on them, and they have an expectation that part of the rite of what Jesus did for them, that through his blood, healing was given. It was for them. They didn't have to wonder if God wanted everyone to be healed. Well, there's another component that we haven't walked in yet, but I believe that God is getting us ready for. It has to do with death. We have some examples in the Bible of both Enoch and Elijah who did not die, but they went on directly to be with God. In natural DNA, what happens is DNA tends to duplicate and to copy and help cells that way. There is a weakness that eventually tries to come in regular human DNA, and it's at the place where it reproduces and copies the next generation of cells. And because that happens, people age, because the duplication isn't the same as it was supposed to be. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's lost some power. When you are in Christ, what does it say about you? That you are a new creation. What does that mean? Well, we have isolated that thought about being a new creation in Christ to mean that we have been brand new in the Spirit. And believe me, if you weren't brand new in the Spirit, none of this would be possible. This is all based on the finished work of Jesus Christ and his life, his death, and his resurrection. Without that, this would not be possible. We are solely dependent on Jesus. But I want you to understand that that not only does healing belong to you, but eternal life belongs to you. When do you think eternal life begins? When you go to heaven? What did Jesus say about it? He says, eternal life is this, that you know the Father and you know the Son. That was Jesus Christ's definition of eternal life. The word know could mean this word that has to do with conception, that Eve knew Adam intimately. So when we know Jesus, because we have been conceived and made anew through him, we have eternal life. Is that correct? Yes. Eternal life not only means the brand new spirit that we receive as Christians, but it means a regeneration and a healing and a wholeness for our body. God's original intent with Adam and Eve was that mankind should live forever. Is that true? When Adam and Eve sinned against God and made a mistake, their life force, although it was very, very great because they lived eating of the tree of life, they lived in the direct presence of God himself, was very strong. So it took many hundreds of years for them to die because the life force was so strong in them. Is that true? And then we noticed in our lifetime, well, not maybe in ours, we noticed that lifespan used to be shorter, but now it's growing longer and longer. Isn't that right? Yes. And so we see that lifespan is going to increase, even in a natural way, because of something that happened, because we have been made one with the living God. What did you really think your being made one with God would do for you if it didn't touch you in eternal life? I mean, did you ever ponder what it would mean to be one with God, to be one with his DNA? That's what you have received through Christ Jesus. I believe that in the future, that the body of Christ, just like it woke up to healing, just like it woke up to other things that are ours through the power of the Holy Spirit, is going to wake up to an understanding of what it means to have eternal life. And that eternal life can represent or look something like Enoch and Elijah, or it could look something like Jesus when he was resurrected from the dead and his body was glorified. That isn't something we're walking in right at the moment, but it has a great potential for the future, wouldn't you say so? And for you to dismiss that and say, oh, now that's scary, is just as foolish as people would say healing isn't for everyone. Yes. Just as foolish. In science, as we speak, is investigating what I told you. They've come up with something they call the immortality gene. They find that every human being is born with this gene, but it is not turned on. So they're trying to find a way through serums, through activating different cellular situations, to turn that gene on so that their goal is to reverse aging, so that the symptoms associated with aging would be reversed and people would be brought back to what they looked like or how they were when they were in their 20s. There are animals in the earth, mostly in the sea, that have this kind of immortality gene turned on already. The next time you eat a lobster, it is an animal that technically doesn't die by itself. It dies because it's caught, or maybe it has predators in the sea that eat it, but left alone, do you know lobsters can live about 700 years or more? Because they have something inside of themselves that keeps regenerating them. They grow real, real big, huge. Also turtles. And there's something called the immortal jellyfish that was discovered by us, by a gentleman in Italy. Genoa, Italy. He was swimming in the ocean many, many hundreds of years ago. He found this jellyfish. He thought it was interesting. He brought it home, put it in a petri dish, and watched it. And instead of it dying, he noticed that something was happening inside of it. It began to regenerate itself and bring itself actually back to a point where it was first conceived, where it first came to life. And he noticed that. And people have been studying that ever since that, because science understands something that we don't always understand in Christianity, that God made us in his image and likeness. In Hebrews, it says this. It says that Jesus is the direct reflection, the direct representation of the Father. He is not just a copy. He is the Father. Is that what it says? We are not even a copy. We represent and we are the Father. We are the Son. We are the Holy Spirit here on earth. We're not comfortable with this kind of conversation because it stretches our mind a little bit and we're afraid, oh, maybe we'll go off in a tangent and we'll be some occult group or something like that. May I tell you, when John G. Lake was healing people, that's exactly what they thought about him, that he was a maniac, that he was taking this healing stuff way too serious, even though he had 100,000 documented healings and Spokane was declared the healthiest city in the United States. They said, you can't go there, but John G. Lake had a belief system. His belief system said, I am one with God. And based on that belief system, he did extraordinary things in his time because he would not allow himself to be held back or afraid of what man thought. He put his confidence in the Holy Ghost. This is the challenge to us today. God did a good and complete work in us, didn't he? He did. He made us one with him. What does that mean? It means that when we say, and I've heard people say this, dying is part of life. Oh, no, it isn't. Never was. God has nothing to do with death. There is no death in the personality, in the nature, in the characteristic of God. None. He is life and life more abundantly. He is life and everything life means. Body, soul, and spirit. We're on a great journey. You come to church and you think, oh, it's the same old thing, it's the same old thing, this, that, and the other thing. I'm telling you and I'm challenging you, press in to what the Holy Spirit wants to say to you. Don't be afraid to let your light really shine and have people's lives be touched by a loving God. Death is one of the scariest things people face here on earth, isn't it? Anybody here in a hurry to die right now? I mean, be honest. Even though you have the understanding that you're going to go be with Jesus, still, we fight to live, don't we? But we have been given life, and life more abundantly. And we're going to catch up on that curve of what the blood of Jesus has already done for us. We're going to catch up. And there are going to start to be reports of some of these things happening. And we're going to begin to hear about it. Because our God is an awesome God. And you just remember that. You just remember this. In case somebody wants to challenge you or be unkind to you because you're daring to believe something a little bit more. You just remember this. None of this would have happened except for the finished work and the blood of Jesus Christ. There is one God, and he is the God of all. And that's the God we serve. And it is through his blood that we have been made whole. And when God says whole, he means whole. And he means now. And you can walk or begin to walk in the reality of that now. Amen. Claudia, you might have to say some more? I know I didn't mark it. I didn't do any. Sorry.
I'm just going to give you some things as we're contemplating this. I mean, haven't you ever wondered, why is it that Jesus took death upon himself and yet I have to die? And it says none of us will see the second death. Well, we've already been dead spiritually. And just like Jesus, the way he rose from the dead, he became sin. He couldn't die before he became sin. So how did we die? When Adam and Eve sinned, then death could come in. And Jesus, who knew no sin, became sin, and therefore he became mortal, died. And so how did he resurrect? He resurrected by the same way that you and I resurrect, the same way we give ourselves to him. He received the spirit of righteousness. When he received the spirit of righteousness, it's as though he was the first born again Christian. That's why he's called the firstborn. That he wasn't the first human to ever be born. He's called the first to ever be raised from the dead. Well, how's that? He raised people from the dead. Obviously, he's not the first. He's the first to go from spiritual death to spiritual life, and therefore, death can never touch him again. So how is it that here we are, and when we get to be a certain age, if we make it to a certain, we die. Just exactly like what Mary said, for a long time, people thought, no, there's no such thing as healing. For a long time, we thought, tuberculosis, it's a way of life. Yes, it happens. Till we found out how to conquer it, and then we never have it again. I'm telling you, the revelation that God is bringing to the body of Christ is we don't have to die, not just get old and breathe. I'm talking about we don't have to die. There's a regeneration, a youth restored where we wouldn't have to. Jesus, he tells us these things, and I'm going to give you a few scriptures just to kind of contemplate on, okay? It says in Romans chapter 5 and verse 21, all sin can do is threaten us with death, and that's the end of it. Grace, because God is putting everything together again through the Messiah, invites us into life, a life that goes on and on, world without end. Now, we all agree that we have eternal life, but we must agree that eternal life begins here. And I'm telling you that Jesus had a choice when to die. Pilate said, I've got the authority to take your life from you. And he said, no, you don't. God does, and I have the authority to give my life. Paul gets a death penalty, and Paul says, wow, I'm hard-pressed between two things. Should I die, go or should I stay? I'm telling you something. He made his decision when to go. He said, in fact, I'm going to go in here, and I'm going to die there. And they said, no, don't go there. They gave him the prophecy. Who's ever bound by this belt? You're going to die in there. And he said, stop breaking my heart. I'm ready for this. People didn't decide when he would die. He decided when he would die. And he could have stayed on. And listen to what Paul says. And you guys, buy the notes. Give me a buck. You'll like these notes. Here's the thing that Paul says. He says, here's what I want. That I would even live the resurrected life, even while in the body. Even while here in the body, that we would live in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we know that sickness has no right to us. Why? Because he became sickness. We know that sin has no right to us because he became sin. We know darkness has no right to us because he became dark so that we could become light. We understand that. But he said he died once for a few. Oh, well, once for all? So he became sick, therefore we must become sick. Okay, so he did it in our place, on our behalf. So I don't have to be sick because he took that on him. I don't have to be anything to do with darkness because he took it on him. But what about death? I thought he died for me, and he died for you. So why do I got to do it? It's already been done. But we've received no revelation of it. Isn't it weird how you can read the Bible over and over again? We read about translocation, but we haven't been translocated. Why not? Because we've got to realize it's for us now. Think how many people read about the Holy Spirit and just read the scriptures. They don't understand. They can have him. Think how many people read about the miraculous and they read about all the wonderful things that God does. And they don't understand that they can have it right here, right now. What if God is beginning to open up a revelatory realm that we don't have to die? I preached a funeral yesterday. I hope it's my last one. That would be incredible. But God needs to start somewhere in this DNA so that we can spread it out through the body of Christ. I'm going to challenge you to do something, to read the scriptures about Jesus conquering death. He says that he died, even so consider yourself dead to sin and alive unto him. He says, I am the ever-living one. I live in the eternity of eternities, and we live in him. He says, I died, but see, I am alive forevermore, and I'm holding, what is he holding? The keys of what? Of death, hell, and the grave. And then in Matthew 16 and 18, and then in also Matthew 18, he says, behold, I have given you the keys of the kingdom. So who's holding these keys now? And we're holding these keys, and we don't even know how to use them and how to open anything up and lock anything up. And remember, he looked over at John, and he looked over at his friend, and he said, there are some here that won't taste death till they see me coming to my kingdom. What? Like that's possible. Jesus said it was. So the challenge is to start looking into this and seeing if it's actually true. Elisha, when he died and he was buried, and some man, they were burying him, and he touched his bones, that DNA that was in the ground raised up the dead. It's pretty incredible. Sin came into the world through one man, and therefore death came in. Life came into the world by one man, Jesus Christ. Righteousness came in, and therefore there is life for all, according to the word of God. The spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set us free from the law of sin and death. And we've got to understand this and start seeing this. That we really have been engrafted in Christ. I'm going to give you one scripture, and then we're going to go into communion. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 9 in the Amplified Bible. It's going to be on page 6 if you have notes. Hebrews 2, verse 9. We're able to see Jesus, who is ranked lower than the angels for a little while, crowned with glory and honor, because his having suffered death, in order that by grace God's unmerited favor of God to us sinners, that he might experience death for every individual, like it was an exchange. The Message Bible, it says, what we do see is Jesus made not quite as high as the angels, and then through the experience of death, crowned so much higher than any angel, with the glory light of Eden band light. In death, by God's grace, he fully experienced death in every person's place. He says in Hebrews 2:14, since then, these his children share in flesh and blood, physical nature of human beings, he himself in similar manner partook of the same nature, that by going through death, he might bring to naught and make of no effect him who had the power of death, that is the devil. So does Satan have the power of death? No. Who has the keys? Quick, quick, come on. Whatever he has, you have. And we have those keys. And guess what I'm doing with my keys? I'm locking death so it can't hurt me or anybody in my DNA. How about you with your DNA? How about that we're one DNA? How about according to the word of God, we're absolutely one with him? How about when it says death shall be no more, sorrow shall be no more? It doesn't mean in that day, it means now. What if it actually means now? What if Revelation isn't for the future, but actually for right now? What if God really wants us to get a hold of this? Now, I want to tell you something. When we partake of communion, according to the word of God, this, the word cup, means your lot in life. Jesus took the cup of wrath, indignation, and death. He drank the cup of death so that we could have the cup of blessing and the cup of life. And the Bible says when we partake of this cup, we are partaking and his very blood, DNA, flows through us. His blood is not sick. His blood is not dying. His blood is not aging. His blood is alive. We saw that his blood is alive. And when we partake of this, we're to judge ourselves according to the blood and according to the sacrifice. And he says, you actually become. I was a living bread that came down from heaven. And by partaking of this, you become the bread part of the ceremony. You become the life givers. We've had Adam. And by Adam, we took on the nature of Adam. Now we got born again and we have the nature of a life-giving spirit inside every one of us. A life-giving spirit. And when we partake of this, we are proclaiming that he died. Now, why are we proclaiming his death? Because I don't have to do it. That's why. And so judge yourself living. Judge yourself healed. Judge yourself righteous. Judge yourself whole. Judge yourself as one who believes the true word of God. Now, up here, when you stand up, if you would, up here, when you come up, there is grape juice on this side. It is labeled. Then there is some sweet wine. Then there is some regular wine. There is some bread or crackers that look like fish, two different kinds. There's gluten-free bread. There's the Jewish bread. And there is the Ritz crackers. This is your smorgasbord. Come up. Get it and go back to your seats and we'll partake together because we're going to partake today in bringing in the eternal life of Jesus by that ever-living blood that is still crying out for mercy. We'll move it this way so you can go on both sides. Good move, Dale. And you have to kind of lean over to read the signs there. You know, I did this for a reason because some people said, I won't take of communion because I have a gluten intolerance. Okay, get the gluten-free one. I won't take of it because it must be grape juice. I won't take of it because it must be wine. I won't take of it because it must be red wine. I won't partake of it. I want us to have no excuses as to why we won't partake of this. Let's partake of it. I won't partake of it unless it's matzo bread. I won't partake of it. No, let's partake of it. Jesus said, do this and do this often. And Jesus wanted us to do this often so that we could call him to the forefront of our mind. Jesus said, and he longed to have this meal with his disciples so that he could remind them that your covenant, the promise Jesus has for us, is his body and his blood. That's the promise. And quit judging your neighbor if they took wine, okay? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. You're set free from addiction, so don't worry about it. Lizzie, can you come up here for a second? Liz, can you come up here if they need more grape juice? You can help them. Thank you, Jesus. Remember, grape juice is at the end, and if you need more, Liz will get you some more. There's cups and grape juice down below. The sweet wine is really good, by the way. It's really good, both the red and the white. People said, yeah, but if you're going to use wine, you're supposed to use red for the blood. And the cups are in that little bag there. Thank you, Jesus. There's still some grape juice. There's still a couple of them, but in case they need more. It's in the front row. So. Thank you, Jesus. Just a couple more. Thank you, Father. And when you get your communion, I want you to, does anybody else need grape juice? There's two more left still. Be bold. Be strong. There's still two left if they need some more. Grab me any. Grab me. Those are grape juice. That's grape juice. Okay. That's fine. Yeah, if they need it. I just wanted to make sure that everybody got what they wanted. Thank you, Jesus. You can tell the grape juice because it's in little kitty cups right there. Thank you, Father. Hey, we did pretty good. We're pretty evened out there. This gets you to get yours right here where you are. All right. So, Jesus says in 1 Corinthians 10:16, when we drink the cup of blessing, aren't we taking into ourselves the blood, the very life of Christ? And isn't it the same with the loaf of bread we break and eat? Don't we take into ourselves the very life of Christ? We are going to be taking in the very resurrected life of Jesus, that which death cannot touch in any way, shape, or form. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16, it says, he keeps us in step with each other. His very breath and blood flow through us, nourishing us so that we grow up healthy in God, robust in love. Now, he said, this is my body. This is the living bread that has come down. We're proclaiming that he died, and guess what? We get to have living bread, proclaiming that we are one bread with him and one bread with one another. Take and eat. I think I'll crunch in the microphone. Thank you, Jesus. By this, we are taking in his life. Our life has been judged as dead. We now live his life. We live by the faith of the Son of God. And he said, this is your new lot in life. This is my DNA. This is my blood. And when you take this, let it be my blood that rules your life. Let it be the eternal blood, the blood that heals, the blood that makes even your enemies to be at peace, the blood that gives total reconciliation, the blood that covers everything and removes all sin, and the blood that continuously cleanses you. Take and drink it. It's your covenant. Thank you, Jesus. Mary?
I just have a few words to release today, but just I want you to think of the prophetic as a ministry that, you know, what makes the prophetic so powerful in people's lives is that it's a way of looking at people through God's point of view, how God sees us. And God sees us as one with him, made in his image and likeness. And that's why sometimes when people get prophetic words, those prophetic words are not, they think to themselves, well, I would never do that, or I could never do that. But remember, God is looking at us through the same way he looks at Jesus. He's looking at us through the light of who he is. You know, I just wanted to say this. You know, in natural DNA, people who maybe have some not so good family traits in their family, people say, well, it's kind of encoded in that DNA. And like people say, well, yes, diabetes runs in my family, or alcoholism runs in my family. People in my family have had this. And science says, well, it's encoded in the DNA message, but it needs to be triggered before it becomes active. Do you understand? Just because it's encoded doesn't mean it necessarily will come to pass. I like to think of the prophetic in light of being in Christ and having God's DNA is what triggers us to live like Jesus. Does that make sense? So the triggers we have because we belong to Christ are for life and life more abundantly. So when God calls out something for you and you say, this is a great thing. I could never be this. God is triggering something to turn you on the inside so you could move in the perfection to which God created you. Can you believe that? I really believe that. I think that's why the Bible says that everyone should prophesy, because everyone should be able to call that in to somebody else to bring them to an awakening or a help so that they will know who they are in Christ Jesus. And we could prophesy over ourselves as the Holy Spirit gives us utterances so that we could help ourselves understand who we really and truly are. Can't we? We really can do that. So that's why. So when you're going to prophesy over somebody, be thinking about that, okay? Will you be thinking about that? Because prophecy is really a lot about revelation, not always about something familiar. Could you stand up for a moment? What's your name, sweetie?
Kristen.
Kristen, would you all extend your hands towards Kristen? I was sitting right there, so you were kind of in my vision place. And what I want to say over you is my heart really felt something for you today. I felt like you were stuck. And basically, and kind of bottled up because of hurt. So this is an appointed day for you to get set free and to be released. Because you have a very bright future. And you've been discouraged in that. You're a very creative woman. And you have some ideas. And there's some more education for you to grab a hold of, too. You're not done. Maybe you haven't even begun with that role of it. But there's some more education so you could walk in the fullness of what's in your heart to do. I think since you were a little kid, a little girl, you were led a certain way. And you had already a desire in your heart for how you wanted to be when you got big. God is in agreement with you today. He sees that future for you today. Do not let the hurts in your heart limit you in this season. Do not let the words of man limit you in this season. Do not let the opinions of others rob you of your divine destiny. God said, if I be for you, who can be against you? We open a door for you today in the Spirit, in Jesus' name, so that you could walk through it and that you could begin to move away from what's been keeping you low. Because the Bible says, when they make you low, you shall say, there is a lifting up. There's a lifting up over you today in Jesus' name. Amen. I feel a lot of heat on that. Did you feel any heat on that? Yeah, isn't that weird? I feel a lot of heat on that because the Holy Spirit stepped in to touch you because he loves you so very much. Amen. Don't be afraid to trust people. Don't be afraid to love, even though you've been burned. Okay? Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Amen. I don't have, you know, because I'm kind of excited about what Claudia shared, what we heard today, and I just feel it like bouncing off the walls and hear them, so I feel bouncy. But what I want to do is, there you are. Shannon and Hoka, why don't you come up here, and will somebody hold that sticky thing for them so that they, thank you very much. Patty. Well, I have you standing here, and just, I'm just catching Marcia just in my vision for a moment. And Marcia, God is saying to me to tell you, hey, Marcia, just get up and be ready because the next phase is right here, right now, okay? It's like, oh, this has been sort of it's been sort of like that kind of a time. That's when I'm feeling, wow, what do I... But the next, God says, Marcia, get ready. The next phase is right here. And it won't be behind time. It'll be right on time because I think the time is now. So you'll watch this evolve and you'll be able to go, oh, yeah, I'm going to do, yeah, right. I got it. Okay?
Yes.
All right. Thank
you. Can I actually give a quick testimony based on what you talked about today?
Oh, sure. Yeah. You sure can. We'll do that. Just... And Jane has an announcement, so you guys just have to kind of remind me so I don't not do it right. Can I have the elders of the church come up? That'll mean Patty will have to pass that to, well, not even Aaron's. Well, Aaron, if you don't mind just hanging on to it, that'd be great. That'd be great. Here they all come. We try to do that every time you guys come into town because... I believe something very special about the nation of Germany and the surrounding countries, that just as we're believing for an outpouring of the Spirit here in a unique way, they're going to see the manifestation of that there too. And here's what I heard God say. It was slightly different. God said, you know, you've done some investigation. You've done some things with people outside of the church for a while. He said, guess what? I am going to bring some people into your life who they're inside the church, okay? Because they're going to be some strategic people that you'll make some plans with for the future. So God is kind of, the outside of the church people are still great, but the inside of the people, you're going to be amazed that there are people in the nation of Germany that are going to come close to you that think and see things like you do, and they're going to be Christian people because they have the same feeling inside of them that you have for what God wants to do in the continent of Europe. So get ready, because that is sort of a next feature of what God's going to give you. Also, as a couple, and this is important, as a couple, this is a reorganization and a redefining time. And God is so loving and so kind, and he's right with you, right here in your midst, because this is supposed to be a refreshment and a time of rekindling for you as a couple. And God's going to be, that's even before you get involved with the Christian people, that's like number one in his mind, because he cares for you. So that's something that needs to happen very, very much, okay? And I just wanted to speak that in Jesus' name. I still see Berlin in your future. I do not believe that, but I think this piece has to be stamped good. You know, it's stamped good. I'm just saying it has to be put in its bestest, most bestest, bestest place so that this next piece could come to pass, okay? Because otherwise, it could be harder, and God wants to make it easier. Shannon, as much as you don't want to hear this part, I'm going to tell you anyway. Those people who have pastored a church, eventually you will pastor something. It won't be any kind of traditional church. It won't be anything that has the same look of maybe an American church. But I'm telling you that the people in Germany are ripe and ready for what you have. They hope and pray you are right about the God you serve, and that the miracles and demonstrations and the prophecies and signs and wonders, they hope you're right. They've been waiting. And even the people who've come into your nation as refugees, they have been waiting. So God has orchestrated a wonderful group of people in Germany who are ripe to receive the goodness of God and know about the goodness of God. And so that, I'm not saying that's in the future that you're going to see tomorrow, but that's in the line.
Yep.
And it's heading closer as
our
we speak.
Our lifespan has expanded now, so we have a lot of time.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So I just want to say that. And for you personally, Shannon, and this goes for you too. And you're delivered right now from sadness in Jesus' name. Absolutely delivered. No more. There is a real, okay, not like a maniac in there or anything like that, but someone very, very happy who's waiting to come out.
I'm working on it.
So I speak for the evolution of that happy one in Jesus' name, because, Hoka, that's who you really are, and you're a man of some pretty great ideas, and you have a heart that loves people. So that's a very good God combination. So I'm calling that forth in Jesus' name. Amen. Shan, you are free. And I speak to your dreams right now that they are altering and changing. You will not dream the former things that have to do with the past. God is going to give you dreams that have to do with the future. And they will be joyous and wonderful, and filled with direction, and filled with spirit, and filled with promise. And you will be a lady, and you too, who has money. And that's part of it, okay? But I'm just speaking for that in Jesus' name. Do you guys have anything you want to share? Patty, could you come up here so they can maybe see you, and I'll move away?
Some time ago, I gave you a prophecy about the tree of life and that the leaves are for the healing of nations. And I hear it again, and it's nations. It's not one nation. It certainly is for Germany, but even as she spoke about the refugees coming in the church that you have, there will be a sending forth, and those people from other nations will take that healing and go to their nations so that God can work his plans.
First, I think last time you were here, I gave you a word, and I said it was time for you to take your rightful place in the Spirit. I just wanted to remind you of that again and let you know that you still question yourself. You think sometimes that you're not at the level you should be, you know, biblically, spiritually. You're wrong. You're wrong. You have everything that you need, and you can be the spiritual head of the household. You are the spiritual head of the household. You have every gift in these hands that you're supposed to have. You have the gift of prophecy in this body here, in this spirit. You have everything Shani has, and more if you want it. You have to quit saying you can't, and you got to say, I can and I will.
I can and I will.
Amen. And I know last Saturday when I talked to you, I was acknowledging the authority that you carry. I wanted to tell you today, it was really funny because I saw a filing cabinet. I saw your name on a file inside, and I saw a hand reach in and take your file out, close the filing cabinet, scatter it in the wind. And to me, that meant you've reached a level where you no longer need to be in a filing cabinet. Okay. Anybody else?
When Mary was talking about your home, I was seeing you guys. I agree with the pastor thing. You guys are awesome. I seen in the spirit that a traditional church, like a European church, very big. That's you guys. You got the traditions. You got the stability. It's there. But also I seen it was like a rave inside, and you guys are gonna bring. Because you know the people you're involved with. They're not going to be interested in normal church. They're going to be interested in your parents' church, what your parents have taught you, and you're going to do this rave kind of thing, and you're going to touch this generation. They're going to be interested in that, but you're going to have the tradition, you're going to have all the biblical foundations and everything, but it's going to be a party inside. It's going to be what they need, what they're going to be interested in, but it's going to be the stability, the everything you've been taught here, but it's going to be awesome.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
I'm allowed to talk because I'm the pastor's kid. No, I just wanted to say just something really interesting just to confirm everything. I mean, we know the gifts that are going on here. We know the amazing things, the incurables that are happening on the first Saturday of the month, that it's actually healing the incurables. And so please bring your sick and everything like that. But I just wanted to give quickly, Mara said, and Colin, about freedom. It was so funny. Friday, I think, Mara said, ask God now. He's here. I can't remember exactly what I said, but I internalize is ask God for what you want right now. Your biggest dreams will come true. Ask him for it. And the saddest thing ever is I didn't have any dreams, and I asked him for dreams. And I said, God, I don't have any dreams. And I said, the only thing I do have is I want to be so rich that I can help everybody. And I said, so that, and I even prayed that, money wouldn't change it, something like that, because we're already prepared to be those billionaires that are just helping everybody and starting organizations or whatever. But then I just said, I don't have dreams, so please give me the dreams. And it's just so cool that, I mean, immediately he says that he's going to give me dreams, and he's going to do this. So this is just really amazing stuff. I just love this. One last thing, again, I know that they're going to play up the wrap-up music and turn the lights off and on, but I kept hearing this one thing, and I just wanted to do this. This is a very common name, so I know everybody's connected to this, but this part is not common. Paul. I kept hearing the name Paul, but Paul hides behind another name, and Paul is an autistic person. I don't have anything more than that, except that I'm praying for him. And if you know a Paul that hides behind another name and is very autistic, God's thinking about him and putting him on my heart right now, so bless him.
Okay. There you go. Okay.
No, it came to my mind for you too. You have your firm foundation, and what you build on it is up to you. So make sure your general contractor is who he's supposed to be. But shame on you guys for sneaking away. I didn't know everybody had gone.
I'm here. Marcia, you had something, and Jane, you had an announcement. Wyatt, do you have any announcements? Okay.
I just want to thank everybody for helping on Tuesday in feeding the people at First Nations. Padrell's Barbecue is donating barbecue this Tuesday because they want to be part of this ministry. So I know it's like, so if anyone wants to come on Tuesday and help, you'll get a barbecue sandwich. Blessings.
Thank you. I know, I've heard it a lot. It's good, it's how people remember my name, so it's a really good thing. So today we were talking about Jesus and the DNA of Jesus, and actually I was given a miracle healing in my DNA from Jesus. I had an illness that... I went to doctors in two countries, and they told me it was incurable. And I was environmentally ill, and I became intolerant to minute levels of chemicals. And it pushed me out all the way into the Arizona desert for 3 years, where I lived in isolation. And so what happened to me is, after you have enough people, doctors, telling you it's incurable, I thought, well, you know, I have no other hope other than God. But I had gone and had genetic testing done, and it showed that in the body there's some detoxification pathways. And because of my genes, my DNA, I didn't have the chemicals in my body, or sorry, I didn't have the enzymes in my body to be able to detoxify chemicals. And this is an illness that my aunt had and died of, and my cousins have, two of them in Canada have. And what happened to me is that I said, I just pressed into Jesus and I said, you know what? I don't believe that. I don't believe that. I don't believe that lab test and those blood tests. And I just said, you know what? I don't agree. And so what happened is he came and he touched me and he healed me 100% of something that doctors in two countries said were incurable. And so my message to you is that you think that things are being passed down and that they're hereditary and that it's incurable. Don't believe it, because there is science, and then there's medicine, but then there's God. Amen. And God trumps all of that.
We have an announcement in the bulletin, but part of it is missing. We're going to have the elders are hosting a potato bar next Sunday, and we're asking people to please sign up to bring salads or desserts. There's sign-up sheets there on the back, and then we'll have it after church next week. We'll provide the potatoes and all that other stuff, so come and enjoy it. Elders are coming to pray.
What God is showing me when I got to church this morning is a hip. He's showing me a hip and a knee, and I believe it's bone on bone on the hip that a doctor would probably say, well, we need to remove and replace that hip and possibly the knee, but that's not God's way. He says, I can fix that, and there's healing here today for that hip and for the knee. And he's also showing me, he shows me this a lot, sciatic, the sciatic thing where the nerve, I can see the little nerve that goes through the hip bone and causes all that pain when it's kinked. And so if anybody has any of that and wants to be come up here and we'll pray for them. And if you're watching on the internet, I believe that healing's coming for you today, right where you're sitting, for your hip and your knee and your sciatic. Okay. So.
I just was gonna say really quick. I'm so sorry. Again, I get to live 6,000 miles away, so then you can guys can forgive me by next year. But she got healed. I mean, this is an incurable disease, and
Claudia, did you want to say something?
Just elders and
okay.
Her prayer over there.
Okay, so if you still need prayer, the elders will be up here for your dining and dancing pleasure, and Leanne and the healing people will be over here to lay hands on you. Otherwise, please sign up if you want to be part of the little potato bar experience next week. God bless you. Hey, if you have any time on Tuesday, why don't you please join us for prayer at 7 o'clock? We'd love to have you. Bye.